A sense of lament hangs over this river. Melancholy, as though a stifled wail awaits release. Gomti, on its banks, unfolded a most colorful chapter of Indian history. A chapter called Avadh, and its capital, Lucknow. Ruled by an aristocratic lineage of Nawabs, men who had realized a brief period of Indian renaissance against the run of history. Gomti, like the city on its banks, loved the Nawabs and their indulgence, their gracious lifestyles, and their patronage to music and the arts. Alas, it was an interlude of history that was to be rudely cut short. No shot was fired, no blood was shed, yet Lucknow wept. For the armies of a ruler who lived beyond the seven seas would become her master, while her Nawab would be exiled, incarcerated. Jaane Alam, Wajid Ali Shah, would never come back to the banks of the Gomti. Though he would permeate the collective subconscious of a larger India one day. Standing proud testimony to the heyday of Avadh, the reign of Asafuddaula, is the Bara Imam Bara of Lucknow. Built to provide for famine relief, the monument eloquently narrates a glorious period of Indian history. The patronage of Asafuddaula and the subsequent rulers of Avadh turned their capital into a cultural bastion of North India. A liberal and progressive modern society which subsumed all sectarian identities to forge a composite culture. Here was an oriental township that welcomed the new thinking from the West without cloning it. The erstwhile town of Lakhanpur on the banks of the river Gomti evolved into the bustling capital of Avadh, called Lucknow. Nawab Jafar Mir Abdullah, the descendant of a lineage that boasts of Asafuddaula and Wajid Ali Shah. His proud gait and demeanor testifies to a link of continuity. In the Lucknow of the late 20th century, today the capital city of Uttar Pradesh, Nawab Jafar represents Lucknow's involvement with its romantic past. Nawab Jafar walks down these lanes, surveying what once was his ancestors' fiefdom. Today, out there is a whole civilization that is in touch with its present reality, but occasionally looks back for reference to analyze the fading away of a lifestyle with time.
Amadani ke zaraye kam ho gaye. अखराजात वैसे ही रहे, अपनी इज्जत भी बरकरार रखना थी, अपना रखरखाव भी रखना था, अपनी वजादारी भी कायम रखना थी। अब हुआ ये कि नवाबीन खामोशी से अपनी जायदाद, अपनी ज्वेलरी, अपना और असासा धीरे 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 तलफ करते गए, तबाह करते गए।
By the time Avadh rose to prominence, British traders were beginning to find firm footing in India. Contrary to popular belief, these men were enamored by the lifestyle led by the Nawabs and often tried to emulate it. However, as business plans transformed into imperial designs, a value system was imported from Europe, and history began to be written with this colored perception.
This whole attempt to change Lucknow's identity to a quote-unquote a very dubious kind of respectability, this has actually eroded the foundations of Lucknowi culture.
Filmmaker Muzaffar Ali traces his lineage to the royal family of Kotwara, who were a rural vassal of the Awadh Nawabs. Muzaffar symbolizes the modern Lucknowi, whose intellectual evolution and opinions have been subject to various diverse and conflicting points of views. It was Muzaffar's film that captured Lucknow's rich culture on celluloid. Even for Indians, Umrao Jaan was to become a window to Nawabi Lucknow. The courtesan, Umrao Jaan Ada, has come to personify the gracious elements of this period, whose refinement patronized the liberal arts, was evolved enough to accept women as equals, and accorded the courtesan a position of respect and dignity. These lanes once resonated with music and dance. The exchange of paan, or the betel leaf, and the elegant entreaties of an encore. Numerous styles of semi-classical Indian music today owe their continuance to this gracious patronage of the rulers of Awadh and their nobility.
Delhi. जवाल की तरफ था. वहाँ के जो आलिम व फाजिल, शायर, पेंटर्स, कारीगर, फनकार, वो बेचैन थे कि अब जाएं तो कहाँ जाएं. नवाब आसिफुद्दौला बहादुर ईरानी नस्ल के थे. उनको इन सब चीज़ों से दिलचस्पी थी. जब लखनऊ में तशरीफ लाए तो उन्होंने इन सब फनकारों को दावतनामे भेजे और उनको दावत दी और उनको लखनऊ बुलाया.
हमारे जो पर बाबा थे ठाकुर प्रसाद दुर्गा प्रसाद जी, उनका बहुत ही नाम उस वक्त रहा. और जो मेरे पास घर है आजकल गोलागंज में, झावलाल पुल, भैरोजी रोड, गोलागंज, वो मकान भी उसी वक्त का दिया हुआ है नवाब साहब का. तो वहाँ क्योंकि कृष्ण के प्रति अच्छा भाव था, मान सत्कार था, तो बाबा को भी अच्छा लगा कि चलो भाई नवाब अली शाह को ये सब पसंद है. तो ये वो नाचे हैं. और उसके बाद महाराज बिंदादीन जी करीब 12 साल के थे उस वक्त वहाँ पर, वो भी नाचे हैं.
An exponent of the dance form himself, the Shia Muslim Nawab culled out romantic Hindu legends of Radha and Krishna and wove lyrical dance dramas choreographed in Kathak. The paan is still there. Little else is left. Classical music and dance, once the gracious preserve of Lucknow's nobles, have now been co-opted by a new urban genteel. The surviving architecture of that period, the Baradari and the ruins of Dilkusha, is also a pointer to the rising European influence. The liberal rulers of Awadh welcomed the achievements of the West and tried to incorporate some of it to the benefit of their kingdom. This school, established in 1848 during the reign of Majid Ali Shah, stands testimony to that liberal attitude of the Nawabs. Co-opted early into the Lucknow ethos, La Martinia Boys remains a part of the city's proud heritage. The school also provides a link of continuity between the period of the Nawabs, the Raj, and the post-colonial emergence of Lucknow as a modern city.
Outwardly, the link between the Awadh culture and the colonial culture, or rather the European culture, is visible in La Martinia because of Asfodala's relationship with Claude Martin. After 1947, a certain amount of integration and certain kind of amount of assimilation of cultures begin to take place, and I think La Martinia is responsible for that.
However, for the warlords of the East India Company, Awadh sovereignty was an inconvenience they could ill afford.
After a point, they realized that Wajid Ali Shah was going beyond their control. You know, he was no longer a dummy ruler, as they thought. His depth of reach into the countryside was far greater than any other ruler before him. And this happened essentially because of his great regard and creativity for both classical art forms and folk art forms, because he became a folk legend, you know, himself in his lifetime. So finally, the British had no option but to depose him and exile him to Calcutta.
A century or more later, master filmmaker Satyajit Ray was to adapt a Hindi short story by the renowned author Premchand, delineating the epochal events that were to follow.
Na koi goli chalegi, na koi jang hogi. Wajid Ali Shah apna vaada pura karenge. Aaj se 3 din baad, 7 February 1856 ko Awadh par angrezi qabza ho jayega. Jaane alam apni mehboob Lucknow nagri ko hamesha ke liye chhod kar chale jayenge. Aur Lord Dalhousie aakhri cherry हड़प कर चुका होगा।
Wajid Ali Shah's exile to Calcutta transported an idiom of culture to the then capital of the British Raj and found patronage among an emergent nobility comprising largely of merchants and landlords. Years later, emergent technologies would mold and carry the idiom to various corners of India, and the idiom itself would become part of the collective subconscious of her people. Rita Ganguly is a professor at the famous National School of Drama in New Delhi. Born in Lucknow, Rita spent her childhood and formative years in the city.
As a prisoner to Calcutta, Matiya Bhuj mein jab le gaye, unke saath unke gawaiye bhi gaye. He did not leave them. Aur wo musicians hain jo ki baad mein in turn Calcutta ke logon ko sikhaya, jaise Angur Bala Devi wagaira, ye unhi se seekhe hain jo Wajid Ali Khan saab jinko le gaye the apne saath.
Wajid Ali Shah's emotional involvement with his beloved Lucknow was total. And it is his emotional and romantic persona that has come to symbolize all that Lucknow ever wanted to be. But destiny had ordained otherwise. Lucknow was smarting under the humiliation caused to its beloved Nawab by the company. And their pent-up emotions only needed a spark to ignite. These ruins of what was once the home of the company's resident is witness to an important episode of the First War of Indian Independence. The infuriated Lucknowese, who had capitulated without firing a bullet, had the colonials captive in this building. The invincible Company Bahadur was brought to its knees as more sepoys got a whiff of independence and rallied about. They dreamt of restoring the throne to the Nawab. The siege lasted 3 months, and was only defeated as reinforcements and supplies arrived from other British garrisons. A.B. Frank is a second-generation Lucknowite whose father adopted Lucknow as his home during the Raj and married an Indian. Frank, born and brought up in the city, leads a retired life in central Lucknow. The existence of a strong Indo-Anglican community, more than 50 years after the British left India, speaks of an ethos of coexistence.
I've been very, very happy to live in Lucknow and to live in this beautiful area. I suppose we have changed, and that is why with us, the atmosphere and the environment have changed. It is us who keep changing, and things are changed according to our likes and dislikes.
The legendary pop singer Cliff Richards, a Lucknowi Anglo-Indian, spent his youth in this house, and it was probably his fame that lent a face to this community of Lucknow.
And what he told me I'll never forget until my dying day. He said, son, you are a bachelor boy.
These bridges, three in number, over the river Gomti that separates the city, are a link between the new and the old Lucknow. Today, the refined traditions of Lucknow are manifest as much in the finely crafted chicken work as its music and dance. Kesar Jahan, like generations before her, is busy embroidering a chicken kurta. In her dimly lit house, Kesar B takes days to embroider each piece of garment with fine threadwork. Threadwork that drapes ramp models in exclusive fashion shows and glitzy showroom mannequins across India.
Effort that went into upgrading the skill. To be able to pay them, we realized that the only thing to do is to place chicken into a high fashion and a high visibility structure and a situation where, again, we create the kind of patronage that is required to sustain it.
In the by-lanes of Chowk, Tunda Kababi is a landmark. Each kebab, a mouthful of delicacy, prepared with finesse and exquisite in its detail. Colorful legends surround these kebabs. It is said that the Nawabs were so averse to physical labor that these kebabs had to melt in their mouths, lest they had to masticate. Tunda Kababi is as much a part of Lucknow's folklore as the city's monuments and kebab factories across the country try to replicate a whiff of this aroma in plush five-star hotels.
The Lucknowi cuisine, its style of cooking is called dampukht. Now, dampukht denotes a whole process of slow heat so that the food which comes out is like concrete and yet delicate at the same time. It is a blend of so-called Hindu-Muslim influences. This combination of ruggedness, of sophistication, and the third aspect, which is the sensationalism, sansanikhespan. So, and this is very much reflected in Lucknowi culture.
Known as Akhtari Bai Faizabadi in her youth, Begum Akhtar rose to prominence in the city of Lucknow. With the establishment of the radio station, her voice stirred the entire nation. The lyrically romantic poetry, called the Ghazal, and other semi-classical forms like the lilting tumris and dadras were liberated from the confines of the kotha, the exclusive preserve of the courtesan and the nobility. Rita Ganguly also has the singular distinction of being the longest serving disciple of the great singer Begum Akhtar.
Mausiki sirf gana gana hi nahi, ye puri zindagi ki experience hai jo mujhe unke sath rehne se mila. The Begum Akhtar jinko hum duniya janti hai aaj, that emerged from Lucknow. Wo ek jagah hi aisi hai which gives you that kind of grandeur and ek pani ka thara hua ek kind of dignity jo milti hai.
In the post-colonial evolution of India, Begum Akhtar provided an emphatic validation for India's seminal ethos of composite culture, an ethos that was proclaimed in the erstwhile Awadh and Lucknow. Lucknow sang in the voice of the Begum, and the country listened and rooted for more. In the democratic federal structure of this vast country, Lucknow's importance as the capital of India's most populous state, Uttar Pradesh, is enormous. As the nerve center of UP, the city is dotted with signs of progress and post-colonial development. Some prestigious institutions that power India's sustainable modernization drive are located in the city. Lucknow's central marketplace, Hazratganj, probably sums up the story of this oriental town. Streams of casual strollers are punctuated with modern cars, billboards and neon signs that announce the arrival of global idioms, and an emergent upper middle class which could hardly remain untouched by socio-economic forces unleashed by the liberalization of the 90s.
Just as things have a life of their own and they must die out, and I guess parts of a city will also die out, they will crumble, and upon that a new element will be built. A city is not just its buildings, a city is its people, and I think the people of Lucknow will always maintain that kind of tradition of closeness, that tradition of Pehle Aap, as we call it in Lucknow, the tradition where we like each other, we're comfortable with each other, and we are not in any way frightened of each other or distant from each other.
At the turn of the century, it's a sprawling mini metro that has grown far beyond the limits of Asafoodola's capital or the one occupied by Lord Outram and his forces. While Lucknow has accepted, even welcomed change with an air of dignity, it bears its heritage with a palpable air of pride. The Lucknowese conviction that they symbolize all that is refined and cultured overrides their travails of transition. A conviction that will perhaps ensure a romantic continuity, even as the old gives way to the new. A continuity symbolized by Gombe and the lamenting tumri that Akhtar Pia or Wajid Ali Shah composed, leaving her banks.
Angna to parvat bhayo aur dehri bhai. अंगना तो पर्वत भयो और देहरी भई विदेश ले बाबुल घर आ चली पिया के देश मोरा अपना बेगाना छूटो जाए बाबूला।